comments myself and let Lauren do the talking here. Our presentation is for, we have a time of about 2 hours, including Lauren's presentation, our questions and answers. Following this, there will be a 1.5 hour dinner break. There's food available here, or you can go elsewhere in the neighborhood. There is a talk from 7 to 9 with Bhaskar Sukara and Paul Heidemann from Jacobin Magazine on technology and socialist strategy. I'm from this point, I'm giving the mic right over here to Lauren, and let's get going.
Can we move that stand back over here so I can?
Run it up here.
Hi, everybody. Thank you for turning out today. as Michael just said, I'm Lauren Goldner. some of you may know me as a co-editor of the online journal Insurgent Notes on the little... Sorry? I'll try, but it's going to be hard for me to say. You can't hear me?
No.
Okay. Remind me when I put it down to my side, which I tend to do. That's why I put it on the stand. But OK. so I'll start over again. I'm Lauren Goldner. I'm co-editor of the online journal Insurgent Notes. I've handed out a chronology of what I'm going to be talking about, which has the URL of my website, Break Their Haughty Power, as well as the URL of Insurgent Notes and my email address if you want to send me comments, criticisms afterwards. Before we really get going, I was told that some of the writing on this map is a little sketchy. I tried to make it as clear as possible, but let me just quickly go over the geography that I will mainly be talking about. First of all, of course, this is China, and the major cities that will be coming up periodically are Beijing, the capital, Shanghai, which is right here on the coast, and Hong Kong and Shenzhen, the very important special economic zone that was set up in the early 1980s when China decided to open up to foreign investment in a big way. And then Guangzhou, which is the capital of Guangdong province, which is probably the most important part of the Chinese economic expansion going back to the early 1980s. And then, just for sort of geographical reference, Japan, North and South Korea, Taiwan, Vietnam, India, and then within China itself, well, this may be controversial, Xinjiang province, which is a largely Muslim province, which is being rapidly settled by the Han population. That's the main ethnic Chinese group, which is about 93% of the total population of China, which at the moment is 1.4 billion approximately. And then here is Tibet. And some other important cities, Chongqing, which used to be known in English as Chongqing, probably the largest city in the world at the moment. It has over 30 million people, and it was recently the site of the fall of a very important high-level party official named Bo Jilai. And I think that's about it for geography. Sorry if my handwriting is a little problematic, but I'll be pointing to the different places as we go along. I'm not by any means a China expert. I did live in South Korea for 4 years, where I became very involved with the Korean working class movement. This was between 2005 and 2009. And of course, in the milieu of working class militants, I found, of course, many people very interested in what was going on in China and very struck by some parallels between what happened in South Korea from the 1970s up till the 1990s. Of course, South Korea has 40 or 50 million people. China, as I said, has 1.4 billion. So, and of course, they're very different in certain ways. But what they have in common was a long period of very rapid growth under what we could say is an authoritarian development regime, which led to, in 1987 in South Korea, a working class explosion that really, in some ways, blew up the foundations of the development dictatorship and led to a transition to a more open democracy. And along with that, the beginning of the downsizing and breaking up of the previous economic development in South Korea, which had been going along at 8 to 10% a year, just as China until recently has been moving along at about 10% a year, at least according to certain figures. Okay, so I would like to sort of begin at the end and then circle back and talk about historically how things got to where they are in China today. I would say that China, as part of the world capitalist economy, is, of course, deeply enmeshed in and influenced by the crisis of the world capitalist economy. We noticed about 3 weeks ago that the Chinese stock market lost $3 trillion of market capitalization in 3 weeks, about 40%. It has recovered somewhat by a massive state intervention. I find it rather hilarious to read the commentary, the English language commentary on this state intervention, saying, oh, this just proves that they haven't made the full transition to the market, as though the US government didn't spend $700 billion in 2008, didn't take virtually all the steps that the Chinese government and central bank have taken, with some exceptions. So it's definitely right in there. I would say, broadly speaking, and this is the core of what I'm going to be talking about, is that the Chinese model of capitalist development is now, and for some time, has been in a very serious blockage. This blockage is just part of the blockage of world capitalism that's been going on for quite some time. But in China, it has, as they say, special characteristics. And the way in which this is going to sort of work out will definitely involve the question of the working class. Now, there are various international models that have influence China in some way or another. Let's start with the one that is kind of the nightmare of the Chinese regime, and that's the Polish Solidarność explosion of 1980-81. It's been studied very carefully, as has the collapse of the Soviet Union in 1991, as kind of a model to be avoided. And what really is of concern to the top levels of the Chinese state, of course, is that Solidarność ultimately, over a 9-year period from 1980 to 1989, broke the political monopoly of the ruling Communist Party and opened up a Pandora's box of different kinds of truly independent political parties, and very quickly led to the dismantling of the so-called socialist regime that had been in place there for 40 years up to that time. China has many think tanks, and these think tanks have studied 8 or 10 or even a dozen models from around the world that have influenced what has gone on there. let's start with, as I said, the collapse of the Eastern European bloc, the collapse of the Soviet Union, was something that was very much on the minds of the ruling circles, particularly because it occurred 1989 to 1991, exactly at the same time as the famous Tiananmen confrontation with the state. And I'll come back to that, but I just want to quickly say that, as in many cases with disruption and revolt and confrontation in the West, the way in which the West views China, it was viewed, Tiananmen was viewed primarily as a student uprising. But in fact, it was a student and worker uprising with more and more working class participation as the as the crisis got to its culmination in very early June 1989. And it wasn't only in it was not only in Beijing, it was in a number of cities around China where popular crowds attacked the People's Liberation Army when it was trying to come into the cities and put up different kinds of resistance. In Beijing, most directly, several tanks were destroyed by crowds, and there was a lot of street fighting with people killed on both sides. When the PLA finally was ordered to take over Tiananmen, the main square in the heart of Beijing, the first thing they did was to head for the tents of the worker organizations that had set up there in the last days of the crisis. And this is a theme that we'll come back to, that again and again, at different turning points in the development of the PRC, the People's Republic of China, workers have played a much understudied role as far as Western commentary is concerned. So basically, what I see is a situation in which, as they say classically, the ruling class can no longer rule as it did before, and the subordinate classes, and particularly the working class, can no longer tolerate what has gone before. And the question, it's a very large and complicated question, is what is going to replace the current model? This has been an open issue in China since at least 2008, when the world financial crisis, particularly the crisis centered in the United States, kind of undermined the previous Chinese development model of heavy, massive exports to the West, and above all to the United States. That was kind of, you know, that a curtain came down on that phase of accumulation. And ever since that time, the Chinese state has been spinning its wheels and looking for the next step. And generally speaking, if you follow the mainstream Western press, the next step is supposed to be a consumer-oriented a consumer-oriented new phase of accumulation there that would be based on raising wages and opening up more opportunities for the middle classes in China. I'll return to the problems with that outlook towards the end. But let me now go back to 1949 and sort of trace out the way in which China got to the situation it's in. 1949, in my opinion, was what I call in my little chronology a bourgeois revolution with red flags. Now, what do I mean by that? Basically, bourgeois revolutions classically, going back to the French Revolution, are revolutions that destroy the pre-capitalist class in agriculture. This happened in France, this happened in Russia, it happened in China. Between 1949 and 1952, about 2 million landlords, various definitions, were, well, they were expropriated. and from that point on, because the regime, the new regime under the Communist Party, nationalized all land, and to this day, all land in China is nationalized. If you want to build a house or have a farm or a golf course, you lease the land from the state, but it's not your property. Very important to keep that in mind. The initial phase, and there's great controversy over the nature of China. Some of you may be familiar with it. Some people say it was state capitalist, or is state capitalist, is becoming state capitalist. Other people call it state socialism. Other people call it bureaucratic collectivism. And these debates have been going on for a very long time, and I don't intend to get into them unless people want to in the question and answer period. But let's just say that broadly speaking, all of these analyses agree that what was established in 1949 was a new class society in which what I characterize as a transition to capitalism, a transition in which part of the bureaucratic elite of the party was a capitalist class in formation. Now, the metaphor that I use for the early period, well, let me just briefly sketch out. From 1949 to about 1956, 57, a lot of capitalists who had already existed before the revolution were allowed to continue functioning. A lot of small and medium-sized enterprises were tolerated. But it's starting in 1956, 57 that the regime really moved towards a much more regimented bureaucratic model. Model from where? From the Soviet Union. The Soviet Union had a tremendous impact on the early formation of the Chinese Party and the Chinese Party in power. Tens of thousands of Chinese Party cadre had been educated in the Soviet Union. Soviet advisors were all over the place in the early period. And basically what was implemented there was something quite similar to the Stalinist bureaucratic model that had taken over in the Soviet Union in the 1920s. So, now of course, China being China, not the same country, different conditions in certain ways. But, you know, a certain number of things that China had in common with the Soviet Union. First of all, a massive peasantry. At the time, 1949, about 80% of the population lived on the land. Today, it's 50%. So there's been a gradual urbanization, although you have to be careful using that term because it includes about 270 million migrant workers who are not really settled anywhere. This is something that is very important to understand how the Chinese regime works. There is a residence permit called the hukou, which is something that is issued at birth that basically gives you rights to social services, housing, etc., whatever the state provides in your place of birth. And these 270 million migrant workers today in China, their hukou is in the village where they came from, out in the far provinces. So there's a constant instability there. The hukou has been very important in controlling the relationship between the country and the city. In the last 10 or 15 years, I understand it has been loosened up a lot, and a lot of migrant workers have managed to get the hukou in the cities they live in. But nonetheless, it's still there. It's still very important, and above all, was very important in the past. Now, in 1956, 57, there was the first crisis in the Chinese regime. And it was a part of a crisis of the world communist movement, characterized, as I'm sure most of you know, by Khrushchev's speech to the 20th Congress of the Communist Party of the Soviet Union, by the Hungarian Revolution, and by the so-called Polish October, which shook the regime in Poland. In Hungary, it was an out-and-out overthrow of the regime, which was crushed a few weeks later by a Soviet military intervention. But as with Solidarnosc 15 years later, 25 years later, the regime in China studied those events very carefully, knowing full well that the conditions for such a revolt existed in China as well. And guess what? In 1956-57, you had the first strike wave of any importance since 1949. Again, as with later, as with Tiananmen in 1989, the Western focus was all on the intellectuals. There was Mao's famous 100 Flowers opening up the criticism. It rapidly turned into a flood of criticism far beyond what had been expected. And then Mao kind of turned and arrested a lot of people, crushed the movement. He said, oh yes, the 100 Flowers, that was letting the snakes out of their holes so we could beat them down even better. But what was less publicized in the West was a simultaneous intensification of strikes in Chinese industry, above all in Shanghai. And Shanghai historically has been the center, or was the center, of the Chinese working class, with real traditions going back to the 19-teens and 1920s. Nonetheless, the regime stabilized and continued, I should say, the next step was from 1958 to 1961, the so-called Great Leap Forward. Great Leap Forward was a hyper-voluntaristic attempt, as Mao put it, to catch up with England and several other Western countries in some very short period of time. I don't remember exactly what it was. But what it came down to was a massive movement in the countryside in which peasants who are now in communes were boiling down, melting down the family heirlooms and working around the clock to greatly expand agricultural production. And what happened? What happened was a famine in key agricultural regions of China in which, depending on whose estimate you want to accept, between 20 and 40 million people died. The Great Leap Forward was a colossal failure, and Mao took heavy criticism inside the party from members of the party elite for this failure. And according to the sources that I rely on, Mao was essentially, as I say in my little outline, kicked upstairs, kept as a figurehead, too important to remove, but nonetheless, real power devolved fully to what you might call the technocratic wing of the party, the people educated in the Soviet Union, the people who wanted to follow the Soviet model, and Mao and his faction were marginalized. Not too long afterwards, in 1965-66, you had the beginnings of the so-called Cultural Revolution. Now, I don't like the term Cultural Revolution, because it had nothing to do with culture, and it wasn't a revolution. But it was a faction fight at the top of the party. It was an attempt by Mao and his faction to regain power. And the so-called capitalist roaders, the Liu Shaoqi faction, the people who were widely attacked in propaganda, were this very same Soviet-educated wing of the party. And I would say that by and large, the Cultural Revolution lasted for 10 years. But the mass mobilizations associated with the Cultural Revolution were basically over by 1969. But it's very important to keep in mind that during the Cultural Revolution, workers began to revolt, not against Liu Shaoqi, but against both factions at the top of the party. And Mao, in 1967, shortly after this all got started, sent the People's Liberation Army, the PLA, into Shanghai and elsewhere to put an end to these disturbances and cool things out. Nonetheless, the result in the short term was the triumph of Mao and the people who later became the Gang of Four, including Zhang Jing, Mao's wife, or I guess partner, as one would say today. And they essentially ruled up until 1976. Now, it's important to note, and I just put this down briefly, all universities were closed in China for 10 years. 17 million youth from the cities, many of them university students, were sent down to the country to work in agriculture, learn from the peasants, teach the peasants, overcome the gap between mental and manual labor. And there's a very interesting book I just came across recently talking about what happened to these 17 million people who essentially became a lost generation in China. Many of them were not allowed to return to the cities for 10 years, till 1976, at which time some were able to resume their university studies, but most didn't. Many of them wound up doing petty temporary work. Others wound up in in gangs. There was a whole raft of possibilities or block possibilities. Many of them escaped to Hong Kong. It's a very common thing, particularly for anyone who was lucky enough to be Russified down here in southwest China to swim over to Hong Kong and start a new life. But in my opinion, the Cultural Revolution took a great toll on Chinese society. And if you go to China today, you'll meet most people. When they talk to you, will say, "Oh, how do you do? This is my name is so-and-so." Oh, and the Cultural Revolution was a terrible time in China. This is the official line. And I would say there's a lot of truth to it. The official line of the party is that Mao was 70% right and 30% wrong, the 30% being the Great Leap Forward and the Cultural Revolution. And I met many young Chinese since I came back from South Korea, and most of them know absolutely nothing about that time. It's not taught in schools. It's not talked about in families, by and large. It's just a kind of huge blank space in people's understanding of how China got to where it is. Okay. Cultural Revolution ended in 1976. Mao died. Zhou Enlai, his number two colleague, also died. I point out there that at Zhou's funeral in the spring of 1976, 200,000 people turned out in Beijing in what was essentially an anti-Gang of Four demonstration. And around the same time, a democracy wall was established in Beijing, covered with these bright multicolored posters called Da Zi Bao, meaning poster. And there was a very lively debate going on. And during that time, there was a faction fight happening between the re-urbanized people, the party elite who had been sent down to do farm labor during the Cultural Revolution, who gradually came back to power in 1978. Headed, of course, by Deng Xiaoping, who ruled until the early 1990s. And was essentially the architect of the new Chinese economy. This was essentially the return to power of the technocratic elite that had lost power during the Cultural Revolution. things got out of hand with the democracy wall. It was shut down when some people started, Deng had talked about the four modernizations. Modernization of industry, agriculture, education, and science. And many people started talking about the fifth modernization, democracy, whatever they meant by that. And this was not welcome, and the democracy wall was shut down. China was into a new period. And I don't know how much detail I can go into. I think I should probably pay a little attention to the time. But as we all know, this new phase from an economic point of view was tremendously successful. China grew, according to official figures and most generally accepted figures, at about an average of 10% a year from the early 1980s up until recently when it started to slow down. Now, when we look at those figures, we really have to keep in mind a couple of other things. First of all, is the environmental destruction that went along with that, which is enormous. Everyone has heard about the perennial smog in Beijing, the health hazards created by that, the poisoning of water, the poisoning of food that periodically has erupted in scandals. So if we start to deduct the total cost to, let's say, infrastructure and the environment, that 10% annual growth is probably seriously reduced. But nonetheless, whatever one wants to say about it, it's been very impressive and unprecedented in the history of capitalism. Of course, it depended on 200 years of earlier industrial development, but nonetheless, quite something. So it went through a number of periods. Probably the most important thing to understand what ultimately happened is the way in which in the early 1980s, the regime opened up free markets for agricultural produce, starting in a couple of provinces. And then within very few years, China was kind of overwhelmed by a 500% increase in the production of food in certain areas. And Deng Xiaoping himself said, this was not our plan. It just happened. As soon as the peasants, were no longer in the communes, but free to sell on an open market, agricultural production exploded. Similar things happened in the Soviet Union and Eastern Europe, but nothing on that scale. I think by the end of the Soviet Union, 1% of land, which was allowed to peasants for their own private production, produced 25% of all food that reached the cities. And I bang on about agriculture because it's very important, obviously, when one wants to think about how is the working class being fed. And cheap food from the countryside everywhere has always been A, B, C in terms of getting an industrial working class and industrial production off the ground. Then came 1989, Tiananmen, and the revolt that I talked about earlier. Now, the initial phase of the opening up of China did produce pretty serious inflation by the late 1980s, and a lot of discontent. Although the regime had not yet moved to seriously privatize either industry or the rest of society. And so that is certainly one of the main things in the background of the massive participation of workers in what started out as a student protest. Now, as I'm sure most of you know, the party was really split about what to do about this. And from what I've been able to gather, it was really when large numbers of workers started coming to Tiananmen Square that the regime decided it's time for real repression. And that's what happened not just in Beijing, but in several other cities. But as I wanted to point out, there was street fighting all over Beijing and in a number of other cities, and hardly dominated by students. The repression was heavy enough that things were basically shut down in China for 2 or 3 years. Western governments, threw up their hands and said, "What is this? This is." We thought that they had moved away from authoritarianism, and Western firms cut back their investments. But after a few years, let's let bygones be bygones, and the whole thing was resumed. Now, one thing I jumped over is, in the 1970s, when the United States and China began to have serious relations, starting with Nixon's famous visit to Beijing in 1972, there was mutual interest on both sides. The Western economies and the US economy in particular were moving into a period of crisis. At the same time, the idea and later the possibility of mass cheap goods from Asia as a way of compensating for falling worker wages in the West was very attractive to the Western elite and particularly to the American elite. Now, I haven't found any check stubs or written out documents from the early 70s spelling all this out, but it's what happened. Basically, the whole phenomenon of Walmart full of Chinese imports in the United States as a kind of cushion against falling real wages in the United States was in some sense, it was the core of the agreement. So, 1990s, the boom resumes, and now we get into this period where worker unrest becomes very important in a form that is more appropriate to understanding the current situation. I mentioned 1992, an initial strike wave that was happening. One thing that's, let me now step back and use this map a little bit. The special enterprise zones, SEZs, were begun in the 1980s, I believe, and the most important one was in this little town called Shenzhen. In 1980, Shenzhen had about 30,000 people. Today, it has about 10 million people. It's just an enormous urban agglomeration with 40-story high-rise buildings, one after another. And these special enterprise zones, I'm not sure about now, when I was traveling in China in 1997, Shenzhen was closed off by a 30-foot high barbed wire fence. I happened to arrive in Shenzhen on a bus of peasants who were going to work for Shenzhen. Everybody needed a special permit, and the bus stopped at that very high barbed wire fence. Police or military came on, very carefully checking everybody's visas or permits to go to Shenzhen. The point being that it was a very popular destination because everybody knew that wages in Shenzhen, while they may be bad, there was abundant work that was open to anybody who managed to get there. So Shenzhen took off. like almost no other part of the country. There were a couple of other special enterprise zones along the coast. I'll get to another one in Zhejiang province in a minute. Hong Kong up until 1997 was a British colony that then reverted to China. You can step on the subway in Hong Kong and go to Shenzhen. I mean, they're just, you know, it's Brooklyn and Manhattan. but, you know, of course, you have to go through Chinese customs and visas and so on. So, you know, the real action in the Chinese economic boom is primarily along the coast, although out here in the west, in Chongqing and some other places, it's also taking place, and more, because as worker unrest increases in the coastal areas, more and more firms are relocating out here to cheaper labor markets in the West. it's also interesting, it's something that I learned not too long ago, I mean, when getting into this study, that a surprisingly large amount of land in China is not arable. It's not useful for cultivation. So actually, if I understand correctly, the United States actually has more arable land than China. So, and this is also becoming another problem, because as industry grows and cities grow, all kinds of land is eaten up in the countryside, cutting back again the land that can be used for food production. So, as I'm sure most of you know, China has been reaching out all over the world, and especially in Africa, buying up land, making contracts with different countries for food imports, and trying to assure a steady supply of both food and energy, above all oil. But nonetheless, you know, this is where the working class has been concentrated. This is where the class struggle has really been the sharpest. Now, I mentioned a strike wave that started in 1992, went on until about 1994, in response to the first real pressures of the privatization program. Now, one really important thing to keep in mind is that there are really two working classes in China. There's the old working class from the so-called SOEs, the state-owned enterprises, who are largely, or were largely, concentrated up here in the northeast, the area that used to be known as Manchuria. Now I think we just call it the northeast. And then there's the new working class, which is made up of hundreds of millions of people coming in off the land, either forced off the land as their little farms become unviable, or coming off the land because nobody wants to stay down on the farm forever, and life in the city seems very appealing. This is now just becoming a serious problem in China, because for the first time, that apparently bottomless source of labor power out in the countryside is starting to be exhausted, and above all, through the experience of work in different parts of the dynamic zones, you've got a new maturing working class that is not, in contrast, say, to the 1980s, when there were still lots of people just off the farm who were willing to work for very low wages and take orders and not be uppity and subordinate. That era seems to be over. I'll come back to that. The really interesting working class actions start after 1995. The 1997 Party Congress, Jiang Zemin, who was then the prime minister, announced 100 million layoffs for the coming period of the new of the new economic restructuring. That's almost as many people who were in the U.S. workforce at that time. Now, where did those layoffs happen? Ultimately, I think it was only 60 or 70 million. And guess what? They happened up here, primarily in the Northeast, where the state-owned enterprises were dominant. This was the old classic industrial zone of China. It had industrialized already in the 20s. It was taken over and further developed by the Japanese in the 30s and 40s. And then when the pro-Soviet technocrats took over, they continued to work here, you know, very much oriented towards heavy industry. And by the 1990s, a lot of these factories and the oil industry up here that became PetroChina, with the help of Goldman Sachs, were pretty antiquated. And so the bulk of the layoffs hit this area. And one needs to understand what a shock this was, because for anyone who's worked for 10, 15, 20 or more years in one place, to suddenly be handed a pink slip is pretty upsetting. And the almost immediate response to these layoffs were riots, marches, some strikes all over this area. Unfortunately, most of them not very successful. They were successful often in getting the actual severance pay that they were supposed to get, although in many cases that didn't happen. The managers of many of these plants simply looted the assets of the plants in order to set up the plant on a new basis as an independent enterprise. But by and large, the people who lost their jobs up here were forced ultimately to migrate down to the more dynamic zones and take a serious cut in their overall situation. Now, let me just backtrack a minute and explain what that was in the 1950s and 1960s. As a worker in China under the Maoist regime, you were part of something called the Danwei, which is a labor unit. And everything, you know, it was essentially a cradle-to-grave guaranteed living situation. Wages were not anything to write home about, but it went along with health plan, housing, social insurance, and anything else you'd care to mention. Now, the Chinese working class at the time of the Communist Party takeover in 1949 was 5 million people and their dependents. So, you know, not much bigger than the Chinese working class of the 1920s, which had been so militant and really seemed at times on the verge of leading a revolution. But that's another story in the past we can get back to. A very small percentage of the population, but they had the Danwei, and this continued with the control of migration from the countryside with the Hukou, the residence permit. It was just a gradual growth of urban population and urban working class. Now, one thing that really has to be emphasized for today is that when one says working class, this may conjure up pictures of images of the old working class in the United States or Western Europe, people with steady employment, relatively high pay, et cetera. And then the fact is that there's not really much of that in China. That what there is a huge casualized population that moves in and out of industry or other jobs. And of course, it is not only industry, but now and for some time, there have been many, many small businesses and what are called TVEs or town and village enterprises, some of which have been very successful. So this is not the formation of a new working class as it existed in Europe or the United States up until the 1960s or 70s. But much more churning, much more temp work. For example, in I believe in 2004, a national labor law was passed that made it almost impossible to lay off any worker who had been through two contracts in the place they worked. Now, that was not many people in the first place, and the main response of different companies of different sizes was to move to, guess what, outsourcing and casualization of other workers. So as with everything, that, you know, I mean, China, like the Soviet Union, 1936, at the height of the Stalinist terror, the Soviet constitution was on paper one of the freest in the world. You know, there's always this little matter of enforcement. And in China, a lot of very good labor laws are just simply ignored. I'll give some examples. The constitution or labor law provides for a 40-hour week. Now, not too many people have the 40-hour week. Usually, it's more like a 50-hour week, and in some cases, much more than that. Let me talk about probably the most famous case of the new Chinese working class, which is the explosion of suicides at Foxconn. You know, everybody who's sitting here with Apple equipment, cell phones, iPods, computers, should keep in mind that those things are mass produced by 1 million Foxconn employees scattered around different parts of China, but of course, like most industry, most new investment concentrated here down in Guangdong province. The work conditions at Foxconn were so intolerable that this involved very long working day, lots of compulsory overtime, lots of wage theft, just everything that one associates with the new Dickensian capitalism of the last 30 or 40 years. And finally, in the spring of 2010, 20 Foxconn workers tried to commit suicide, jumping off of various high buildings. Everybody, of course, who works at Foxconn lives in a dormitory, which is as strictly regimented as the workplace itself. I think ultimately 14 people died. Foxconn responded by putting nets high up on the buildings to prevent further suicides. And there was such a wave of international publicity about this. This is really putting a spotlight on the new Chinese economy that Foxconn responded by raising wages. They were announced to be a 30% increase. The reality was more like 10%. I put the figures on the chronology. I think a typical Foxconn worker after this wave of suicides was making something in the vicinity of 2,000 yuan a month, which is something close to $200. That's for a 10-hour day. That's a monthly payment for a 10-hour day with 4 days off a month. And by standards of Guangdong province, that's not too bad, because in the smaller towns and smaller enterprises, the enforcement of labor laws gets murkier and murkier as you move away from the well-publicized big firms. Now, that's another thing that I want to emphasize, which is so far, even though there's more and more open discontent in China, the state bureaucracy has been very successful in keeping all this resistance localized. I mentioned that last year there were over 100,000 incidents in China. That includes, I mean, the figures vary. I've seen anything from about 1,200 to 12,000 strikes out of those 100,000 incidents. I'm not sure, but the bulk of them, in any case, are riots in small and medium-sized towns that result from, you know, the classic case is peasants whose land is seized by the local party officials to build a golf course, to build a luxury hotel, to build luxury housing or whatever, with miserable compensation, if any. And so a riot ensues. Sometimes the compensation is increased, sometimes not. But the point is that so far, in terms of the developing of a general consciousness, as I understand, the hostility is primarily oriented towards the local authorities. And the regime, on the other hand, at the national level, has, you know, talks good. I mean, they, you know, yes, we have to enforce these labor laws. No, this is terrible. Now, as you know, with the new leadership that took power in 2012, particularly the Prime Minister Xi Jinping, they've been carrying out a very fierce anti-corruption struggle in China itself. Now, I haven't seen good a good analysis of what factions are involved in this in any. I can't believe that it's just a random walk who gets arrested. Not too long ago, the former head of the state security police, former member of the Central Committee, was arrested and executed after his trial. So it reaches up pretty high, and of course also reaches down low. But this is part of the legitimation crisis that I mentioned at the beginning. the awareness of corruption is, you know, corruption is so pervasive that the awareness of it is extremely pervasive. One of the things that's truly new in China in the last 20 years or so is the so-called denizens, or people on the internet who, in spite of very serious censorship and controls on what is discussed publicly on the internet, you know, there's a pretty lively, to use a certain term, civil society criticizing the regime, commenting on these scandals, the scandal in which poison milk killed a couple hundred kids a few years back, the scandal of a crash on the new high-speed train between Shanghai and Beijing, which in record time was cleared up with no media coverage or little media coverage or bullshit media coverage, but nevertheless, you know, tens of thousands of people really openly expressed themselves about this scandalous cover-up of the media of these kinds of episodes. Or the earthquake out here in Western China about 5 or 6 years ago, in which no houses collapsed. The only thing that collapsed was the new public school, which had been built by a corrupt public construction company, simply collapsed during school time, killed quite a few kids. This was another scandal. There's just a whole series of things like this, in addition to these basic conditions in factories. Now, let me just wrap this up and let's get into questions and answers. as I said at the beginning, I think there's a fundamental regime crisis in China. It goes along with this legitimation crisis, and above all, the question of what to do about all of these revolts led by an ever-increasing number of working-class strikes. And as I also mentioned, I think the nightmare of the regime is something like what happened in Poland in 1980-1981, where a massively supported working class mass strike sort of breaks the foundations of the regime, and ultimately, at the end of the 1980s, leads to the collapse of the regime, and in short order, of the entire Eastern Bloc, the Comecon, the Soviet dominated countries of Eastern Europe, and ultimately the Soviet Union itself. This is above all the scenario that has to be avoided. Now, what can be done within the status quo to save the rule of the communist elite? I would say, you know, there's the famous old line from a 19th century Italian novel. It's a realization in the ruling class that everything has to change in order for things to remain the same. And I believe that is basically the scenario that a lot of people at the top are thinking about. That if it can be finessed, a transition to, at minimum, a free trade union movement would be the first order of business. Because the All China Federation of Trade Unions, the ACFTU, is largely discredited in the eyes of workers. Now, there are some exceptions to that. There are bureaucrats in the state trade union, which is the only one, who are aware of these problems and talk about them fairly openly, and you know, could be part of a renovation of the trade union movement. there is the whole working class, pro-working class group of NGOs here in Hong Kong and in China, primarily in Guangdong province, who work with worker dissidents and who also would advocate something like a shift to free trade unions and maybe even parliamentary democracy with you know, several other parties being tolerated. For example, one of the leaders of the 1989 student uprising in Beijing, Hong Dongfeng, is today he's the head of a very interesting online site called China Labor Bulletin. That's L-A-B-O-U-R. It's a British established site. Very social democratic, as far as I know, actually funded by some of the Western European social democratic parties. But they provide very good coverage of a lot of stuff on the ground. And they're very much in favor of a free trade union-based new democratic regime on the mainland. So that's, I believe, is the core of the opposition. But as I mentioned a few minutes ago about all the netizens online, there's much larger constituency scattered around various parts of the country. Now, what do I think is going to happen? As Yogi Berra once said, prediction is very difficult, especially about the future. And I think I've kind of been going through a thought experiment. I do not believe that that kind of transition is possible in China. Let's start with number one. A serious increase of wages in China would further undermine the so-called China price, that is, the price at which Chinese goods from the early 80s till recently have been able to really sweep all before on the world market. Already, because of rising wages, due to struggles here on the coast, outsourcing of Chinese firms to countries like Vietnam has become more and more common. Vietnam itself is in the process of its so-called doi moi, or opening, very similar to what the Chinese regime did. There have been three or four general strikes in Vietnam in the last 10 or 15 years. So even Vietnam might become problematic, and beyond Vietnam, of course, is Bangladesh, which also has a very militant working class, primarily composed of women textile workers who have burned down factories and burned down the houses of the bosses. India, which has a burgeoning working class movement. And some people are even talking about a new Indian Ocean rim, which would include newly developing countries in Africa, such as Kenya and Uganda. So there's that kind of pressure on what's going on in China itself. Now, it's very important to keep in mind that, I mentioned, I think it was in 2003, that foreign investment in China became the number one place for foreign direct investment, passing the United States. But where did that investment come from? One might think it came from the United States and Europe. Not really. The number one investor in China is Taiwan. And right behind Taiwan is Hong Kong, where a lot of capital gets recycled from the mainland to Hong Kong banks and goes, they're called round trippers. They just go right back into China as quote unquote foreign investment. Now, as you know, Hong Kong is now part of China, but it has this special status. So those two places are really more important taken together than any other major capitalist country. It's also interesting that starting with the opening in the 1980s, China really drew on the Chinese diaspora around the world. There are billionaires in Indonesia, in Hong Kong, in Taiwan, in the United States, and so on. We sort of felt the call of the homeland and were major investors in the new industries. But like I say, they're investors. They're looking at the bottom line. And if things really got out of hand and there was some attempt at a consumer-based reorientation of the Chinese economy, the China price would go even faster out the window. So in other words, there's a real contradiction in the calls of many liberals and Western Democrats for this kind of reorientation, because the very thing that it would require, higher wages, is what would undermine the ability of China to continue its dynamism. I guess Michael is standing up because I've talked too long.
I'm only getting ready to hand the mic out.
Oh, okay, fine. but I think I have talked too long, and I just want to make sure I have not left out anything important. But yeah, why don't we move to question and answer? And
fine. Thank you, Lauren. Thank you very much.
Okay.
How many questions do you want to take?
At a time? No, one at a time.
One at a time.
My memory is not what it used to be.
Hi. Do you know anything about the role that China and the Group of 77 are playing at the UN on the Sustainable Development Goals project?
off the top of my head, no. What are you thinking about in terms of?
There's a push to have 17 Sustainable Development Goals that the governments of the world are trying to agree to. They're social, economic, and environmental. And it seems like China and the Group of 77 think that the trillions of dollars necessary to finance these goals will be coming miraculously from the private sector.
Okay. well, I'm embarrassed that I haven't heard about this. I follow the Chinese economy pretty closely through a couple of sources, but that hasn't come up as such. But along these lines, as some of you probably know, in the last few months, China has established two development banks. One, the Asian Investment Development Bank, I think it's called, to which it invited all countries in the world to participate. And the United States was a lone holdout. And to the point where even Britain and Germany signed on. It was just a tremendous embarrassment for the United States. I believe this bank is going to be initially capitalized with about $200 billion. And this will follow up on very substantial Chinese investments abroad in Africa, first of all, and Latin America, secondly. I mean, the Chavez government in Venezuela was a major recipient of Chinese loans until recently. Unfortunately, it seems that those loans are not going to be repaid and probably not in many other countries. Right, let me just throw in one other thing, riffing on your question. the boom in China, the boom in China was a tremendous boost to all raw materials producers all over the world. And so countries from Brazil and Peru to Australia up until recently were exporting all kinds of raw materials and energy to China itself. And of course, as China goes into the hole, they go into the hole too. And one thing I should mention as a little background, it's not exactly background, is that there is a world depression underway. there's a general deflationary push going on in all the major capitalist centers, Europe, the United States, and Japan. The central banks have been printing money hand over fist ever since 2008, and it hasn't done any good. And all it's done is increased real estate prices and kept boosted the stock market. But there's very little real direct investment. And that's another reason, I think, that any program of reform, like as I outlined in China, isn't going to go very far. But just coming back to what you said, the way in which all kinds of raw material producing countries really experience a boom along with China's boom is definitely over. So I'm not sure what they're talking about at the UN or the Group of 77, but I think that's the broader situation. I think the
I just want to get to one, two, five, six. Okay, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. That may be all
whatever.
We have time for.
Whatever.
Could you go further into your take of the relations between the United States and China at this point? In terms of political economy. And secondly, you know, I've been familiar with the national security debates of China now going back to the 80s where Chinese admirals, you know, fantasized out there, you know, their zones of control. And now, of course, we have serious conflict going on in the South China Sea between all the ASEAN powers down there and up near
right.
Japan and South Korea. What is your take on this?
Okay. Well, ever since I've been involved in Marxist radical politics, there have always been groups around headlining their newspapers, bourgeoisie pushes for war. And I'm being somewhat facetious, but in fact, I think in the current world situation, if we look at the global, overall global situation, it's probably closer to that than ever before, in the sense that we have growing conflict between the United States and its allies in Asia, above all in the South China Sea, but not only in the South China Sea. As you, I'm sure you know that Japan has just decided to build up its so-called self-defense forces, make them into a real army, and all these other countries, you know, down here in the South China Sea, there are 9 different countries ranging from the Sultan of Brunei to the Philippines who have claims on different parts of the South China Sea that may or may not have oil under them. But China is way ahead of everybody else in trying to move in there, develop it. Now, very recently, as many of you undoubtedly know, Vietnam is allowing the United States Navy to use the bases on its coast as part of the defense in the South China Sea. So here we have bases like Da Nang that were built by the United States back in the 1960s, being open to American military ships as part of a general security move. And then we step back more broadly. There's a growing crisis in Ukraine with Ukraine and Russia. The first American troops just arrived in the Baltic states, I think 500 of them, as a message to Russia about its whatever expansion plans it might have. I think nobody is particularly fooled by that because everybody remembers Danzig, now called Gdansk, in 1939, and its mutual security pacts with the West that didn't really amount to much. What am I leaving out? Well, of course, then there's the Middle East, where things are even more problematic for American foreign policy. So my sense is that, getting back to China, China is and will be the number one regional power in Asia. It's tightly bound, tightly involved with all these other countries that I mentioned. For example, both South Korea and Japan have over 4,000 firms operating in China. So they're not about to ramp up the rhetoric too high against China. And on the other hand, periodically, as I point out in my chronology, the regime has been skillful in using anti-Japanese sentiment to cool out working class agitation, as in the big strikes in the Japanese firms in 2010. So now, and you know, the United States is carrying out intelligence flights over the South China Sea. One in China protests, and the United States says we're just, this is international airspace. One would wonder what would happen if a Chinese fleet was in the Caribbean carrying out intelligence flights over Texas, but we'll see about that in the future. But I don't know, does that answer your question?
Yes, I'd like to know more about what you expect in the future. I understand you lay out a reformist possibility, and then you say, well, it's really very unlikely. Well, what is likely? I understand the boom has, there's been this boom, which is very impressive, but there are certain bottlenecks, including the massive pollution and so forth. The labor shortages you're beginning to mention, including labor shortages of skilled workers, which is a separate category. So, and the worldwide stagnation is going on.
Yeah.
So what is most likely?
Well, as they say, I'm glad you asked that question. I wanted to, as I was trying to think my way through the future scenarios, I was focused more on what a reformist perspective might be. But As I said earlier, I don't think that perspective really has much leg room. So what's the alternative? Let's get back to thinking in the international scene. As I said, you know, we're going into a depression. There's deflation everywhere. this is really going to be big. And in such an environment, China will necessarily be hit very hard. It's already been hit hard since 2008. And my feeling is, even though so far the regime has been successful in keeping protests focused on local authorities and local capitalists, that at some point the working class, you know, as how did Marx put it, the working class is compelled by its situation to develop into a class for itself and move to a more national and international perspective. Now, this will be a long and rocky road, but I do believe that given the general nature of the crisis, the fact that, and I didn't want to get into any heavy theoretical lifting, but because we are in a period that some people characterize as the epoch of imperialist decay or the epoch of capitalist decadence, that's a thesis that I share, there never was room for a new world power comparable to the world powers who came on stream in the late 19th century, and above all, Germany. Germany is another favorite of the Chinese think tanks as a model, you know, to understand continuity and discontinuity. Why? Germany was an outlier that developed into a world power and pushed its way into the world dominated by France and the United, and France and Britain. But unfortunately, that period is over. There is no room for a new world power except by the downsizing of other world powers. And so the Asian miracle of the last 40 years, let's keep in mind, in 1960, 5% of world production was in East Asia. Today, 35% of world production is in East Asia. But unlike in the 19th century, when the working class as a whole was growing, this rise here has been accompanied by the hollowing out of American and European industry, not to mention the sort of paralysis of different developing regimes in what used to be called the Third World, now called emerging markets, where their very modest industrial growth up to the 50s and 60s was largely canceled out by an avalanche of cheap Chinese goods. I mean, I'll give one example of that. In northeastern Nigeria, where the Boko Haram movement was really advancing, northeastern Nigeria used to be full of textile mills. And what happened to those textile mills? They were wiped out by cheaper textiles from China. And one could go down the list of different countries where that's happened. So broadly speaking, I don't want to sound rhetorical, but the old slogan, socialism or barbarism, seems to be me more apt today than it's ever been in the past. Namely, that the crisis of capitalism on a world scale, which is a crisis of value production, for those of you who have read Marx's Capital, has to be solved either by some kind of serious world revolution, or it will be solved by a depression and attack on the working class, of which the last 40 years have been just the foretaste. So basically, I think things are posed in that way. That is, the Chinese working class, which has shown itself to be quite combative on a local level, I think will evolve to more national coordination. There's already a network of militants scattered around the country, and many people are in touch through the internet, but you know, it's nothing yet to get terribly excited about. But there are signs of workers, not to mention people sort of excluded from the working class, the 270 million migrant workers, who are beginning to see that they have interests as a class, as a whole, and hopefully not too distant future will start to move in that way.
Well, that leads to the immediate question. What signs are there that the Chinese working class is acquiring a more national, if not international, consciousness as opposed to just a local one? And putting it somewhat differently, suppose you were an advisor to the Chinese ruling class, and you've claimed that they have no, they can't continue in the old way. And I think you've correctly argued that they can't turn to reformism or parliamentarism, that would destroy them in the course of trying to do so. So what should they do? I think one thing that they must try to do is step up nationalism in order to keep the working class divided from international allies and so forth. And maybe some of this militarism that you mentioned is aimed in that direction.
Okay, let's see, if I were an advisor to the Chinese ruling class, I think you touched on a number of things that I would also emphasize. I didn't mention along the way, part of the German model, which has been very important, at least in Chinese think tanks, I don't know to what extent it gets to people who are actually making policy, is the post-World War II German model of works councils, not to be confused with workers' councils. Workers' councils were created by the Russian and German revolutions in the teens and 20s. Works councils were created after World War II, where workers in big factories got, you know, seats on the board of directors and some power over the management of the plant, and I believe there have even been successful in certain cases of stopping outsourcing and things like that. So that would be kind of the enlightened approach. But as I said, and I presume you would agree, there's not really room for that kind of reform on a large scale. I really think the regime is stuck between a rock and a hard place. That is, they can ramp up nationalism as they already have. And it's not an accident that some of the most militant big strikes of the last 15 years have been at Japanese firms. You know, it's always easy to turn on anti-Japanese sentiment in China, where memories of the Japanese occupation are still very vivid. So I really think that militarism and, you know, I mean, a carrot and stick dynamic with not too much carrot and more stick connected to militarist confrontation, if not out-and-out expansion, is probably the way to go. But I realize that's just a very sketchy answer, and sketchy in the same way as my... now, as for your question about signs that the Chinese working class is getting more aware of its national situation, of course, as we know, the regime is extremely aware of this possibility and this danger. For in 2008, when the crisis hit in the West and suddenly Chinese exports dropped off a cliff, hundreds of millions of primarily migrant workers down here in along the coast, but above all in Guangdong province, were sent home to their villages, and the regime said, while you're back there, why don't you stay there? But that didn't really happen. They managed to come back to the coastal areas and continue to be this migrant class that takes jobs here and there. You know, without going into details, it's very interesting and hardly surprising, ultimately, that a lot of these migrant workers act very much like migrant workers everywhere, or immigrants that we know from American history, where people are very much in touch with other people from their town and sort of tend to flock together in that way. I don't think that really particularly helps acquiring an overall class consciousness. But I have a hard time believing that, given the mobility of people around the country, that there's not some pretty serious generalized awareness of the totality of the crisis and thoughts along the lines of doing something more breaking out of the local level. Now, down here, in Shenzhen and Hong Kong, as I mentioned, are all kinds of nonprofits who are deeply involved. I mean, above all in Shenzhen and more broadly in the industrial areas in Guangdong province, with helping workers you know, get off the ground in terms of an independent union or independent, some kind of reform and flexibilization of the old union bureaucracy, the All China Federation of Trade Unions. Now, I think that is another card for the regime to play for a while. That is, if not necessarily giving up the monopoly of the statewide trade union, at least going along with these bureaucrats. I mean, what China really needs at some level, the point of view of the working class and from a reformist point of view, is a Lech Walesa or a Lula, someone who can really mobilize for what would ultimately be a reform of the trade union movement and an opening up of the political situation, however problematic that would be. so far, to my knowledge, nothing like that has really emerged. But I would say that this area here is where some broader class conception is most likely to appear. That's kind of my hypothesis.
Hey, Lauren.
Hi.
So a lot was made in the US of China and Chinese banks or owning a huge chunk of the U.S. debt from 2008 and on. So that didn't enter yet into what you were saying, so I'd like you to talk about some more and how does that play out in terms of potentials all different directions. And also, the corporation, there are, aside from Walmart, in addition to Walmart, there are also other U.S. corporations all over China. So how does that play out in terms of intersect with what I just asked?
Yes, there are many things I didn't talk about. I was counting on the question and answer period to bring up different topics. Let me just briefly touch on the second part of your question. For example, much was said about the unionization of Walmart China, where Walmart doesn't allow unions anywhere else. but in fact, and this was done under the auspices of the All China Federation of Trade Unions. If you look at the contract that Walmart signed, what is really at the center of it is that the union is committed, as they are committed almost everywhere, to promoting harmony in the enterprise. And well, I think that was in a footnote, but you know, the main part was just all about, you know, and reality. This is the role in 80 or 90% of confrontations that the National Labor Federation plays. You know, it's ultimately there to keep workers in line. But as I said, there are exceptions to that. So as for broader US investment, yes, there's a lot of it, but not as much as from China, from Taiwan, Hong Kong, et cetera. But one thing that's very interesting that's often overlooked in the discussions of the foreign investment in China is that China itself gets a very small fraction of what they call the value added. For example, in the case of Foxconn and its ties to Apple, the ultimate profits that accrue to China, Chinese firms, et cetera, is a fraction of what goes back to the home country. I mean, one of Honda's slogan in China, or one of the other big Japanese firms, was R&D in Japan, production in China, sales in the West. And that is the model for a lot of the foreign investment. So it's not so much like some of the classic examples we know from history of foreign investment really building up some independent industry that can later be nationalized. I don't want to go too far with that. Clearly, there's a lot of it. But it's far less beneficial to China than is generally thought. Now, getting to the dollar holdings of the Bank of China, this is a favorite theme of mine. That's really an albatross. I think at its peak it was about $4 trillion. Now, the only problem is it forces the Chinese regime to keep a very tight control over its currency, which, of course, is beneficial in many ways. If the renminbi, as it's known internationally, becomes, how does this work? I think the current exchange rate is close to 7 renminbi to the dollar. But if it became 8 or 9 renminbi to the dollar holdings of China would become that much less valuable to the Chinese. It would be essentially a devaluation of all those holdings. So, and the United States has been through this cycle several times. In the 60s and 70s, it had huge debts abroad in Germany and Japan, above all. And in 1973-74, the United States said, thank you very much. those debts, of course, representing massive imports to the United States, were devaluing. And we're going to stick it to you for 30 or 40% of what you thought of as your holdings. In the mid-1980s, the United States did the same thing to Japan, where Japan had accumulated vast holdings of American treasury bills as well as income from sales to the United States. And the United States had the Plaza Agreement, where they sat down on one moodless night and forced Japan to accept a revaluation of the yen of something on the order of 20 or 30%. When our old friend Tim Geithner, former Secretary of the Treasury, went to China a few years ago, and he spoke at one of the big universities in Beijing, he was pounded by questions about
is America going to force China to revalue? And Geithner said, don't worry, we have all your interests at heart. And the people there who knew very well about the examples I just cited just burst out laughing. So it's very clear, above all to the Bank of China and to broad parts of the Chinese people, that these dollar holdings are really, at best, a two-edged sword. Now, on the other hand, let me just wind up by saying, the central government in China just poured something on the order of $800 billion into the stock market. Stock market fell by 40% in the late June and early July, and government intervened with both feet and brought it back up to about, I think, 40% of the fall. If you got into the stock market a year ago, you're still way ahead. But anybody who jumped in during the frenzy, like the dot-com frenzy in the US in 1999, 2000, you lost your shirt. And so there's a limit to the amount that China, the central government, can really put into these kinds of things. On the other hand, with these new development banks, the extent that they actually get off the ground as the world goes into the tank, they do have money to play around with. So that's another thing to keep your eye on. Let me just throw in about Chinese investment in Africa, which is really quite something. I believe it's in Mali, where China bought some huge part of the country for its manganese, or one of those key metals or minerals for its own development. And it's done similar things in very productive agricultural areas of Africa. it was a few years ago that South Korea was on the verge of buying about half of the island of Madagascar when that deal was finally vetoed, I don't know under whose pressure. And China has been trying to do the same thing with its dollar holdings and other holdings. The other thing, let me just wind up. China has been trying to diversify out of the dollar exactly for the reasons I mentioned, and now it just has come out that their gold holdings have greatly increased in the last 5 or 6 years. So that's another card that remains to be played.
Two more questions. You're still more?
No, sorry. I like the answer to be redoubling the chance to talk to the other.
Yeah, thanks for the discussion. I'll ask you to shorten it so that way, all of us can ask questions. One is, so the proletarian movement is bigger than the regime itself, at some sort, right? It seems to me that the working class in China has the audacity to erupt a strike. And it shows that the working class is basically militant above the bureaucracy that the so-called Communist Party claims that they have, even though they have the capital power, but that the overall social leverage is pretty much fragile as it's known. So I was wondering if you could discuss more on the proletarianization of workers in China. Also, what took place in Hong Kong last year. I mean, how can you place the uprising in Hong Kong along with the proletarian militancy of workers in China?
Yeah. Okay. Again, But I think about the situation in China to some extent with the various foreign models that I've studied and learned about. And I do think South Korea in the late 1980s is a good example of what could happen. The South Korean working class was very repressed, very fragmented, but it was growing through the 70s into the 80s. And with no organization, there were a couple of phony unions tolerated by the regime. And there were, this is very interesting, this is an aside, a lot of students, like in the West, in the 60s, in the 70s and 80s, got factory jobs. And unlike in the West, those students actually had a real impact on the development of a working class movement underground and surprisingly, maybe not surprisingly, through a lot of churches in China, in South Korea. Then in 1987, all hell broke loose out of nowhere. 3,000 factories went on strike in a very short time. It was a strike wave like 1905 in Russia or other strike waves we can think about. So my feeling is, in spite of the current fragmentation and localization of the Chinese working class, that something like this could erupt very suddenly. And above all, one has to pay attention to the political situation. In South Korea, it was the run-up to the 1988 Olympics, which sort of gave legs to the democratic opposition there that had an influence on the workers. It didn't just happen like that out of nowhere. And similarly in China, for reasons we probably can't completely foresee, but in, who was it, Tocqueville, who said, the most dangerous moment in the life of a repressive regime is when it starts to reform itself. And that's very much on the minds of the Chinese elite now. So any number of missteps could lead to that kind of a reaction. But on the other hand, one has to be realistic and see that there are a lot of obstacles to that. As for Hong Kong, this may be controversial, but I see the movement in Hong Kong more along the lines of the different color revolutions that have happened all over the world in the last 10 or 15 years. I think it's very much in the continuity, to some extent, with the Tiananmen student movement of 1989, with the Statue of Liberty and demands for democracy and things like that. I was very surprised when I was in Hong Kong to find out that the people of Hong Kong, including apparently workers in Hong Kong, don't think much of the mainlanders with whom they, fused in 1997 because they're kind of under the pressure of large groups of people who come over the border. It's hardly a border at this point, but still they are separate entities at some level, and just buy up everything inside and drive up prices in Hong Kong and so on. So I really don't see much future for that kind of movement in terms of the kind of movement I'm talking about, the possibility of real worker revolt. I don't think too many, I could be wrong, but I don't think too many working people in Hong Kong got swept up in it. It was more of a student movement. It was more a movement for democracy, whatever that means. And of course it means something, but I think it's very much in the within the limits of the kind of reform that I think might be attempted on the mainland, but will not really produce any positive results. It's just my hypothesis.
We do have more time. I'm sorry, I jumped forward, but Sue, are you ready?
Okay, hi. I'm wondering, in all of these uprisings of workers in the Chinese economy over these past decades, and you're covering an enormous amount of territory. Are there differences in the responses of women workers and male workers? Are there differences as far as what kind of work people are doing based on gender? Could you talk a little bit about that?
I mentioned once before that I really got into studying the Asian model and worker movements in the Asian model while living in South Korea. And one of the things that was really impressed on me was the crucial role of women workers in the first stage of the working class revolt of the 70s and 80s, because Korea's first step was towards light industry and above all textiles that employed primarily women recruited from the countryside. And they carried out some of the first militant strikes and laid the foundations for a later, broader class rebellion in heavy industry. Now, like happened here, like happened in France, like happened in many different places. You know, light industry is usually the starting point, and light industry is something where women can be massively employed. I'm not suggesting they can't work in heavy industry as well, but I mean, that's historically how it's worked out. in China, of course, it's a little different because China started from a base of heavy industry up in the Northeast. And on the other hand, Hong Kong, which did have textiles and did have toy manufacture, and as far as I know, still does, and other light industries, more women were employed there. As for Guangdong province, in the post-reform period, i.e. since the early 1980s, I'm not aware of women playing quite the central role that they played, say, in South Korea. But on the other hand, there are many cases, and I've only been able to study some of them. certainly, there are plenty of small and medium-sized firms where women are half or more of the workforce. And in some of those strikes, they, of course, played a role. But beyond that, I really can't say. Didn't she?
So you're ready?
Sorry, I grew up in Taiwan, and I came to this country to study in graduate school. But I never learned any communist thought at all. But then for the past 2 years, I retired a long time. But then I have several friends that learned so much on the Marxism. We all came from Taiwan. We start to learn. And I know from Mao's era that the first slogan he said is serve the people. All the people should be equal. That he did that. And then there's no prostitution. That's different from Taiwan. Because after Mao's era, there's erected the prostitution. So, but most people, he increased the literate people from all every book where they can go to education, and then that sort of, that's why intellectual class has to go to the farm to work to learn how they are, labor work will help you more on this Marxism, and because I hardly learned it, but then through my friends, every Saturday we learned it. Rich getting too rich in China is terrible, like here. 99% is only 1% rich. Same out in China. I have no question. I just want to express my
feeling.
Okay. if you want to read about China under Mao, I would recommend a book I just recently read called Lost Generation. That's about the 17 million young people from the cities who were sent into the countryside at the beginning of the Cultural Revolution, and many of them, most of them, forced to stay there for 10 years. the way you describe it doesn't sound very much like what this book describes. They were really, the peasants found them quite useless and didn't integrate with them at all.
They were, when you mentioned there's no courage, that's a little bit wrong. Because I have so many friends right now, they are still, at that time, also, even 10 years, they're still in the courage. Just that, because they let the labor class and the farm worker be able to go to high school and, to get educated.
it's true that colleges and schools did remain open in the countryside during the Cultural Revolution. I was talking about the universities in the cities, which more or less closed down. so the integration of the rustified young people from the cities from 66 to 76 was not very successful. And as I also mentioned, when they finally were allowed to return to the cities, they became a lost generation, just sort of missing in action in the changes in Chinese society. Now, as for the rest of the impact of Mao's policies on the rural population, I think you should take a look also at the Great Leap Forward. And there's a lot of debate about that, but there's no debate about the fact that it basically caused massive famines in large parts of China, and something between 20 and 40 million people died in those famines.
That's also caused by some major disasters.
Yes, okay, fine. But
the author of that book speak Chinese?
Sorry? Absolutely. I mean, I would be dubious about anyone who would write about China at that in that depth without knowing Chinese. Yes, absolutely. So, I'm sorry, I have a different view of Mao's role than you do, and I really would encourage you to look into some of the things that I mentioned. But is there? Oh, sorry. Oh, wait a second. I mean,
I want to ask a question about nationalism, but I do want to make one comment about that interchange. I taught in China from 1977 to 1983. I was there for the first test that was given to college students when the colleges reopened. And for the first 4 years after they reopened the elite schools in the cities that had been closed, everybody who passed the test, both for undergraduate and graduate degrees, were that lost generation. And those people are very, very much the elite of China today. I mean, they were the people who came in, there was no limit on their age. You could take either undergraduate or graduate entry exam, regardless of how old you were. So a lot of people who missed those 10 years, who are especially the children of elite, took the test and passed the test, and either went to college or went straight to graduate school, and then became the cream of the crop, because after 1979, there was an age limit put on it. So you had to be a college-age kid to take the college entrance exam. But those first 3 years, 77, 78, and 79, There were many, many, many people who had spent time in the countryside who took the exam, went to school, and became part of the Chinese elite. Anyway, nationalism. You mentioned Japan, and I guess my question is a follow-up on Mitchell's about the dollar, the perception of your average person on the street. I haven't been following China for many, many years, so I'm just like an observer at this point. But I do know that there, because I read and watch the TV, the Chinese news, that your average person on the street is sort of much more savvy about international economics. And that response that they gave to Tim Geithner about U.S. Policy, whatever, is an indication of that. And it's not just people at elite colleges. I think your average person on the street thinks about the U.S. as not only the place where China has its, I mean, that China owns their treasuries, but it's also the place that has encircled them militarily and is opposing their peaceful rise, so to speak, and that is not going to allow China to be the dominant power in East Asia, and the U.S. wants to continue to be the sole superpower and all of that. So the question I have is blame. You know, when the market collapsed in China last week or a couple weeks ago, apparently most people on the street who lost money or lost their pension dollars or whatever blamed the party. It's not, I mean, like, I don't know who would be blamed here. We would probably blame Wall Street if the market collapsed here. But in China, they seem to be blaming the party for not regulating the market. And that's, you know, so when the party stepped in and spent $80 billion or whatever they spent to prop the market up, that was expected. My question about blame is, what do you think, having followed it more recently, about the potential for those two things to be linked in the minds of Chinese people and for the party, those two things meaning the treasury, the collapse of the world economy on one hand, and U.S. government opposition to any rise of China and insistence on being the sole superpower, those linking those two things and the ability of the Chinese party to utilize that to keep people focused on blaming U.S. or foreign or international economy rather than its internal structure.
Okay, well, just to deal briefly with the first part of your comments and questions, the picture, I do know that some of the people who were rusticated in 1966, 68 were able to resume their studies. But according to this book, maybe this book is flawed, a lot of them were already too old to take the university entrance exam when they returned. And according to this book, a lot of them wound up in sort of the interstices of the urban economy with no clear path. But it's an empirical question. I'm happy to hear another point of view. And I'm also glad to hear that people on the street in China are quite aware of the whole question of the dollar and dollar holdings of the Bank of China. Now, as part of a, I quite agree with you that the United States has been pursuing a policy of encirclement of China. There's no question that, as I said before, you know, if we think of a Chinese fleet off the coast of Puerto Rico and intelligence flights over Guantanamo, we can sort of see an analogy, or the impact that would have in the United States, we can see an analogy to a lot of the confrontation that has been building in the South China Sea. If you look on my website, on the at the URL that's there, you'll find an article from about 10 years back, which interestingly was translated into Chinese and published in a party journal, without my knowledge, but called The Great Game 2, the U.S. on the borders of China and Russia. This is something that ever since the collapse of the Soviet Union and the Soviet bloc has been a major, one can almost trace out all the moves that the United States has made from the Baltics through Eastern Europe, through the Middle East to China in terms of a strategy, above all, I would say aimed at, number one, keeping the Great World Island, that's an old term from geopolitics, off balance, keeping, you know, Brzezinski wrote a great book, a very informative book, I should say, called The Grand Chessboard about 30 years ago, in which he said very explicitly, here's our problem. We're a declining power. What do? We've got to keep all the main potential rivals on the Eurasian continent off balance and at each other, you know, off balance relative to each other. Who are these powers? Europe, Russia, China, Indonesia, and India. I believe that was it. And the United States, again, if one follows that logic, you can see the United States has been, you know, pulling strings wherever possible to keep that part of the world off balance. So I have no argument with your comments about the encirclement of China. I mean, it's definitely, I believe it's part of the strategy of dealing with the crisis in the West, you know, just in the same way that the buildup of NATO in Eastern Europe relative to the Ukraine crisis or new NATO presence in the Baltic countries is part of the same strategy. So in other words, the crisis on a world scale hits all countries, but in the West and in the US in particular, it will not be a merely economic crisis. It will be, there is a whole military edge to it. And yeah, so on that, I agree with you.
Warren, I think that was a great presentation.
Okay, thank you. Thank you all for sitting through it. And
Lauren, do you want to say your websites and your...
Well,
it's on the